Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Very well, welcome to St. Mary's this morning on this fifth Sunday of Easter. And we have one of the great I am sayings in our Gospel reading today. Jesus says, I am the vine, and we'll reflect on that in our worship today. Everything you need is on the separate service sheet for today, so if you've got a yellow book and are looking for your place within it, I'm afraid you'll be a bit confused. Just look at the special order of service for today. And for the words of the Gloria, as we're using the Postern Mass, you'll need the music verse copy if you can't remember the words, which do vary slightly. So if you haven't picked up a music copy, then find yourself one if you need the words for the Gloria and for the Sanctus today. But first, as we gather today, we say sorry for all the things that we have done wrong. Gracious God, we have not loved you with all our hearts. We have not cared for others as for ourselves. In your great mercy, forgive us and help us to lead a new life in your service. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life. Amen. Give us compassion and courage to risk ourselves for those we serve, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We sit for our readings.
First reading is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go toward the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home, seated in his chariot. He was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to this chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I, unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now, the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and starting with this scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch saw him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response for our psalm this morning is, my God, why have you forsaken me?
Thank you.
nations will be told about the Lord, and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it.
Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of the Spirit. We have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Saviour of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the word of the Lord.
In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Now, I need a few volunteers to help me with my talk this morning. So any, especially young people, want to volunteer, come forward. I need lots, so you can come strength in numbers. Or weakness in no numbers at all. Maybe. Oh, good, good, good. Any more? Any others? More from the choir? It's still plenty of room. And if there are any children in the congregation, you're welcome to come up as well. Don't have to be wearing a robe to be at the front. Oh, excellent, good. So let's make a nice line on the front. Any other takers? No? That's lovely. Come, do come forward and line up here. Now, actually, a question to all my lovely volunteers. So, who here is a gardening expert? Hands up if you're a gardening expert. Excellent! Then you are the, without such expertise, I want, I need a bit of diagnosis here. Let's disentangle this. So, have a sycamore. And do you think it's a happy looking sycamore? No. What do you think's wrong with it? And pull your expertise. Anyone else have a... What's wrong with my sycamore? Yeah? Doesn't have enough water? Yes? It's very dry? Can anyone guess why it's not got enough water? Or for anyone else? Yes? It is inside. Well, here's my bit of sorbaria. Would you like to hold some sorbaria? Now, do you think the sorbaria looks happy? No. And what's wrong with the sorbaria, do you think? Too dry. Too dry, yes. There you go. Have a lovelier. It's doing a little bit better, but it's not 100% happy. Suggestions, what's wrong with it? It could be. Not enough water. Why haven't they got enough water? All these three. Yes, it could be they haven't been careful. And something even more obvious than that. It could be that it hasn't rained. But even if it rains, I think those probably wouldn't be very happy. Anyone want to venture? It's not in a pot, in fact. Look at the end. Oh dear, that's not got any roots. Can you see? Even if you put in a pot, That won't do any good for it because it's got no roots because it's been chopped off. That's it. So we've got three branches and they've been chopped off. They're separated from the main stem, from the rest of the plant, and in only 36 hours or so, they're not looking at all happy. In fact, I think they're all dead. But branches, they really need to be part of the plant if they're going to flourish. So hold that thought for a moment. But if I said, I am a pair of curtains, you'd probably say, well, pull yourself together. But in our gospel reading, Jesus said, I am the vine. Now, I don't finish kind of a witty comeback to somebody saying, I am the vine. But that's what Jesus says in our gospel reading. And I wonder what your knowledge is. As you're my gardening experts, what's your knowledge about vines? So where would you see vines growing? Where might you see a vine growing? Might be attached to a tree if it's because they do need to grow up and they need support. Yeah. Could be trained against a brick wall, yes. So it could be climbing plants in overgrown terrain, like a jungle, so using those tendrils to cling on. And in fact, there's a very good suggestions. We get vines even in this country. We might see them in conservatories or might even have them in your back garden. There are great vines grown even in the, not just in the south of England, but they're gradually getting further north as the climate warms up. And you get them down in the southwest because one of our former church wardens, John Hartley, has a whole load of Bacchus vines in his house in Cornwall. So you see vines. Now, does anyone know what the name for dried grapes are? Raisins, yes, and no. Raisins in one, there's one, and there's one other. It is. I throw it out to the audience. Sultanas, yes. Very good. And what do you call the study of growing vines and grapes? Is it grapeology, grapeculture, viniculture, or viticulture? So what do you think? Viticulture! Oh, you didn't take the red herrings. Well done. And lastly, on vines, how many different colours of grape do you think there are? So one answer is two. Two, three, four, there are in fact seven. I didn't know this, I had to look it up. So there are white grapes, which confusingly are actually green. There are black grapes, there are red grapes, there are dark blue grapes, and then we get into the even more strange ones. There are orange grapes, yellow grapes, and pink grapes. But I must admit, I'm not sure I've seen all of those. But seven types of grapes. So, good, so you are now our experts in vines and in grapes. So Jesus says, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Now, I wonder why Jesus used that image. Well, we know that he used the image of grain, and from one of the stories in the Gospels, we hear that Jesus walked through a field and plucked some grains, And he used that image then in some of his parables. So maybe one day Jesus had been with his friends, and they'd been through a vineyard, and maybe thought this is something that's really familiar to them. So he thought they'd use an image, a place that they'd seen. And maybe Jesus had seen the reliable, strong stock, the stem for the vines, or seen the branches growing out horizontally. And maybe he'd seen them laden with fruit, the grapes. And maybe they'd even plucked some and tasted grapes. Who here likes grapes? Oh, very good. So it could be a practical example. There's also another reason why Jesus might have used that image, because it's deeply rooted in the Bible. So if you go back into the Old Testament, into the Psalms, into the prophet Isaiah, the image, the picture of a vineyard planted by God and cared for by God is an image that relates to God's care for his people. So there's two very good reasons why Jesus might have used the image of the vine and the vineyard. I am the vine, and you are the branches. And we're going to make a vine here. So this is the vine, and you're going to be the branches. So if you want to be, well, actually, you can be the main stem of the vine. So we'll start with you, Vicari. If you want to be, do you want to be a branch? If you want to be a branch, grab a hold of the string. There we go. Good. It's not just them that's working today. If you want to be part of the vine, grab a hold of a piece of the string as it comes past. Because there's room for everyone. If you want to be grafted onto the vine, just grab a hold of the string. Grafting, of course, is where you have a main stem or a stock, and you attach something, a different variety. You make use of a strong stem and then add something else that will grow nice. So use it for grapes. So Paul, in the letter to the Romans, uses the image of grafting onto the vine. There you go. If you want to grab a bit of if anyone else wants a bit of a vine, grab a hold. Graft yourself onto the vine, and I'll just pass this forward, so we'll otherwise just spend all service giving out bits of string, which is maybe not the best use of time. But we're gradually getting more and more people into the vine. If you want to be part of the vine, just grab a hold, graft yourself into the vine. And all of a sudden we've got a huge vine. We've got one strong stem, starts from the origin there, Hikaria. Now, so many other people are. We've got so many branches. And if I just, with so many branches, we can look forward to lots of fruit. There we go. There we go. Let's have some fruit. And the more branches we've got, the more fruit we can get. So you'll be pleased. Now, I'm not going to go around to everyone who's got a branch. There you go. Have a piece of fruit. And lots of fruit. A huge vine. This with all the branches grafted on. And Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. But this is all not just because it's vaguely nice to be part of a plant. It's all about fruitfulness. Jesus wants his followers to be fruitful. And that doesn't mean that they're suddenly going to become apple growers or something like that. It talks about fruitfulness as people, and if we turn over your fruit cards, we can see these are the sorts of fruits that Jesus is wanting us to bear. So it's love and joy and, what's on the back of that one? Peace and kindness and patience, goodness, faithfulness, self-control, gentleness. These are the fruits. And St. Paul talks of these in the letter to the Galatians. These are fruits of the Spirit. This is the sort of fruitfulness that Jesus is giving us. This is the fruitfulness that God wants for us. So just imagine what it'd be like if our homes were full of all these wonderful fruits of love, joy, peace, kindness, patience, gentleness, self-control. And just think what it'd be like if our community was full of all these wonderful fruits. And then what would it be like if our world were filled with these fruits? We'd need a huge vine, but as we can see, we can grow a large vine and we can be part of that vine. Jesus says, I am the vine, but my Father is the gardener. Now, if you've seen people tending vines, they do take a lot of care, need a lot of care and attention. They need to be looked after, kept at the right temperature, protected from frosts at the wrong time. But also they need the branches. They need to be pruned back and brought closer to the stem. They're not there just to go out and wander to each side and straggle and squall doing their own thing. But they're brought closer so that they can be more and more fruitful. Because that's what God wants for all of us. God wants all of us to be more and more fruitful. Jesus says, I am the vine, my Father is the gardener. So we need to let ourselves be part of that vine and to allow ourselves to be pruned and looked after by God. And of course we need then to become closer to God. So how can we be part of the stem? How can we be part of the vine? What brings us into the vine? What might make us closer to God? Spread the joy, yes, so we can live the life. Yes, any other thoughts? How can we be part of that vine and know God more? Any other thoughts? Yes? So it's about our faithfulness. If we really trust God rather than trusting ourselves alone. And how else will we become closer to God? What sorts of things can we do day by day that might bring us closer to God? Yeah, so we can listen to God's word and something like the golden rule, loving others, the great commandments, love as I've loved you, and to love God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength and our neighbours as ourselves. So it's in what we do. And we can also do it through our reading of the word and by our praying. But if we're wanting these things, these gifts, these fruits to be part of the world, we need to be like Philip in that first reading from Acts, who takes the word out and he goes to meet the official on the wilderness road. He also goes to Azotus. So how could we take, what could we do to take God's word and God's, the gift that we've been given, how can we share them around the world? Anyone got an idea? So much more than just here in St. Mary's. Going to church, which is a good thing. It keeps us connected to that life-giving love, that abiding in that love, as it says in the Gospel. So it's like the sap that would have kept these branches alive. So we need to be close to God ourselves to be filled with the love of God. But how else can we spread this faithfulness, this fruitfulness abroad, far and wide?
Share the fruit with others.
Sharing the fruit with others, yes. So it's not just a personal thing. It's not just, I'm a tasty grape now. But actually, it's what we do with these fruits, and it's looking outwards. So I think we can do all sorts of things to look outwards. We can look outwards to our neighbours round about. We can see what's happening in the world around us, taking that interest and doing what we can, making those decisions and choices that can bring other people closer to the vine, so that they can be fruitful too and live in the fullness of God's love. So thank you very much, my gardening experts. And I haven't worked out a mechanism for untangling yourselves, so hopefully before communion we can sort of make this string a little bit safe so that we don't trip over it. But thank you very much. I'll let you go back to your places. So let's stand now and declare together our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Circle us, Lord. Circle our church with the light of the Gospel. May we understand more of our faith and why we believe. May we understand more of our doubt and not be too hard on it and ourselves. Bless our bishops. Bless Philip and Francesco and all who carry the responsibility of leading us in faith and worship. Help us all be committed to following you in the everyday and in this fellowship and by encircling others with your love. Keep light within and darkness out. Circle us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Circle us, Lord. Circle our nation with the values of the Gospel. Give to our national institutions, the government, the health service, the unions, the church, give them the values of justice, of fair representation, of concern for the weak and the disadvantaged, of equal opportunities for all. May the generosity of your presence infuse our national life, encourage our participation in it, and inform our choice of leaders. Circle us, Lord. Keep hope within, keep despair out. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Circle us, Lord. Circle our family and friends with the love of the Gospel. Keep them in peace and security. Guard those of our loved ones who are vulnerable. Strengthen those who are struggling. Encourage those on the brink of something new. Bring within the circle those in danger, those caught up in war, those in fear or persecuted for who they are or their beliefs. In the face of conflicts that threaten to drag ever more innocent people into them, circle us, Lord. Keep love within, keep danger out. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Circle us, Lord. Circle the sick and the bereaved in your healing presence. Bring into your embrace those we know who are simply unwell, those in pain, those making their last journey. Circle them in the healing presence of Christ. May it be for them the touch of wholeness. Circle them as we name them now in our hearts. Keep peace within, keep fear out. Circle us, our country, our world, our planet. Never let us slip beyond the reach of your grace. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. We join with them in heaven's song. Jesus came as your light, with signs of faith and words of hope. He touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. The crowds came out to see your Son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, given for you all. Do this in remembrance of me." Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you. Plead for us and all the world. Send your Holy Spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Let us pray. Eternal God, whose Son, Jesus Christ, is the way, the truth, and the life, grant us to walk in his way, to rejoice in his truth, and to share his risen life, who is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all people. First of all, thank you to all those who supported our concert on Friday evening. It's a lovely concert, viola music, viola piano. Thank you for those supported and all those who helped to run it to another great evening of music for us. Today there are various things on. There's coffee and tea in the hall as usual after the service. And there's going to be a little meeting of the Children and Young People Committee. For all those children preparing for admission to communion next Sunday, please stay behind. We'll have a quick rehearsal straight after this service. And it will be quick because I need to be over for the Children and Young People Committee meeting shortly afterwards. So stay behind and come to the front of the chancel here, and we'll have a rehearsal ready for next Sunday's admission to communion. Online prayers are at their usual time this evening. Looking a little further ahead, a week on Thursday is the Feast of the Ascension. It's one of the great feasts of the Church, and as usual we have our sung Eucharist, that's at 8 o'clock, that's Thursday the 9th of May. So do put that date in the diary, it's a great celebration. Then just looking a little further ahead, on the 19th of May we have the Feast of Pentecost. It's the Church's birthday. It will be a day of anointing. It will also be a day when we're offering chance for anyone who would like to have prayers, people praying with them or for them, to do that straight after the service. But also, if you don't necessarily want to come and have prayers in the chapel at the end of the service, we'll have the opportunity for you to write prayer requests. So there are many ways to be prayed for and be part of the prayer of the Church. Obviously, it's lovely if people come and are part of that prayer themselves in person, but also good to pray for people who have requested prayer. So do bear that in mind, and near the day there will be some prayer requests, slips of paper available. Last but by not means least, I know Patience celebrated her birthday yesterday, so happy birthday to Patience. So let's stand now to sing our final hymn.
Jesus,
that great shepherd of the sheep, make you perfect in every good work to do his will. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.